Hayden, where were you on the 6th of October, 2011?
Actually, I was in St. Louis before I came to Occupy. So I wasn't there the first day when everyone met in Pioneer Park. I was still in my travels and in my journey doing some things, you know, kind of living my normal life, as it were. But I had stopped by Occupy St. Louis and saw what they were doing and was excited about what they were doing and had begun following it from, you know, everything going on in Wall Street and then noticing that there were encampments set up all over the country.
Well, what brought you to the encampment at Dallas, and when did you get there?
I had, for the 6 months previous to our encampment at Occupy, I had been just trying to figure out, after getting out of the military, where it was that what I was going to do next, and kind of trying to find what I was going to do, and working within the constructs of my divorce and my custody issues with my children, and then still trying to find a path for myself. I went back to St. Louis from a job, you know, writing sports at Notre Dame. I went back to St. Louis to get my ex-wife and my children out of that situation and back to Seattle, where we had agreed initially in our divorce that we were going to live. So to go back to your initial question, what brought me to there?
To Dallas.
What brought me to Dallas was that I was settling up my claim with the Veterans Affairs, with the Veterans Administration. And I had started it in Texas about 8 months prior to that, and was told that because the VA they don't have a national database. And so wherever I started, I would need to finish up and settle it with them before going someplace else. So that kind of being what was on my mind, it was just one more thing after coming out of the war and seeing the bailouts and the job market and everything that was kind of taking place in my nation. And then kind of firsthand being in this war on terror, when I had seen what exactly that looked like over there, as boots on the ground, as they say, I recognized that something was coming, that we could not go on like this forever. And the Tea Party came, and I really wasn't wholeheartedly with the Tea Party because of some of the ways that it was presented. But I also recognized, looking back, that I was never part of any of the Tea Party rallies. So maybe their message was quite different than it was portrayed on corporate media, just like ours was. So that's kind of the long answer. The short answer was, I couldn't not be at Occupy.
When was your first day at Occupy Dallas encampment? Which of the, there was three of them. You had one at JFK, and then they had one at Pioneer Park, and then they had one at the encampment behind the City Hall.
I believe, to the best of my knowledge, I believe it was day 10.
Yeah.
And they had already set up, and you guys had just been, or we had just been given the permit to have that 30-day or 60-day, what have you, behind City Hall. So that's when I came. And again, I don't remember the exact date, but I can tell you what led up to it. I was actually, when I come back to Texas, I had to go check in with the VA, let them know that I was there and get things started there, and was really displeased with how that whole process was going. And once again, it was big government treating me like I'm some type of freeloader, when like I'm just working within the constructs that they had set up for hundreds of years. And the fact was, it was so inefficient. And the fact that the Veterans Administration isn't a nationally run organization, it doesn't have a database. I just went like, who's running this thing? Who's running our country? And what the heck are they doing? And I just remember being so just disenfranchised until I saw everyone out there. And I just went like, I'm not the only one who cares. I'm not the only one who feels this way. And that energy, when I walked across, I was actually going to the driver's license building, or the driver's license office inside of City Hall. And I left there, and they said there was some bureaucratic hang up, red tape thing, and then I needed to go to that office and not this office. And it was just more nonsense. And I just kind of fed up, and I was planning on checking you guys out anyways, but I definitely was able to come in with more of a fervor than I would have had I not just been through all of these, you know. So I always told myself, whenever the people get sick of this, and whenever the people have had enough, I'm going to be part of that group, you know, because I certainly feel that way.
So did you stay in a tent at the encampment?
I did, yeah. I was very fortunate. Even though everyone was already pretty well set up, I ended up staying with, I remember I just wanted to get involved. Right when I got there, you know, I met Lizzie Wetzel, was the one who kind of gave me my tour and took me and everything. And she had this beautiful, big, bright smile, and she was artsy, and we were doing art with these little kids. And then We went over and she introduced me to Artman, Josh, I can't remember his last name for the life of me, but Josh, everybody knows who I'm talking about. And then they were kind of doing their own things, and Lizzie had to go to work. So I was like, well, how can I get plugged in? Where do I need to go? So I went to the media tent, what was called the media tent at the time. And I ran into Christy, Laura, and Aaron Stouter. And from then I was set. Like after that point, like I was helping organize the first protest we did at Wall Street, at the Wall Street on Cockrell Hill. And I guess that's Oak Cliff.
Tell me about this first protest.
This was awesome. This is when I was hooked. I never had considered myself an activist, although I'd written several things that were kind of out of character for someone who grew up in Protestant church, trophy club type of situation. They just asked me, hey, you're a military guy. Can you help us organize like 100 people to go to Walmart? And so, absolutely. So I started getting involved in that and doing that. And next thing you know, it's like 5 or 6 o'clock and I'm in the back of a Chevy S10 with like 14 people, you know, and I'm looking around and it couldn't have felt more natural for how awkward or you know, different than my normal day-to-day had been.
So what did you guys do when you got to Walmart?
Yeah, that was really cool. And I just wanna, just as like a shout out to everybody who was there, like look at what we did. You know, I know a lot of people kind of felt that maybe Occupy has been shut down or defeated, but that couldn't be further from the case. You can't shut down an idea. You can't defeat an idea. And what we were able to do at Walmart, we took a bunch of these flyers. First off, it was just, I would say there was at least 60 people there. And the 60 people, we went in and we kind of congregated outside and we'd already worked a game plan and then we kind of reorganized once we got there because there was a convoy of probably 15 cars, I would say. And I remember we were just kind of laughing and having a good time. But when we got there, we ran around the store for about 30 minutes. And we were hiding these little tracks, these little flyers. Yeah, there were 4 to a paper, right? Yeah, Christy had been cutting them all day and some other people had been cutting them up all day. And I think we had several. I mean, I think we had like 20,000. I can't remember the exact number, but I know there was a lot. And I was very happy about this. And they basically showed the income inequality that Walmart CEO, I believe his name is Michael Dukes, or something to that effect, Michael somebody. Anyways, and it just explained to the workers there that we're here for you. We're here because we care about your rights and we care about social injustice and we care about the fact that, you know, the 6 people that are the heirs to the Walton kids, the heirs to Sam Walton's fortune, are not anything like their father would have been. These people aren't trying to help. Those 6 people own more than 40% of the rest of the nation's wealth. 6 people versus 40% of a nation of 300 something million, whatever it is. It's obscene. And you know what? I remember that as we were walking around, after we walked around and we'd hit all these flyers for, I'd say, 30 minutes or so, we all met, and this was very unorganized and haphazard, but we all were trying to figure out what was going to happen, and Stephen Benavidez ended up blowing a whistle, and people just let the rest of their flyers just go, boom! So there's flyers everywhere, and then we start going into some of the standard old union busting type of, you know, union busting is disgusting, and just those type of chants that union workers have used for years and years, just classic ones. And so we have about 60 people walking around in circles around the, all the cash registers. It was really intense. It was really cool. And I also recognized at that point that I was all about certain parts of it, but that for me, the yelling wasn't going to be my passion. The yelling, because I've being in the war and yelling and doing all those things, that's not my heart. That's not my role in this thing. But I think each one of us had to go through that organically. Like, what is my role in this new community, in this new collective of peoples that I've decided to share these months within a tent? So let me get a drink of water real quick. But yeah, it was really cool. I remember this Hispanic girl, or Latino girl, what have you. She came up and she had this whole, I mean, she was just very dolled up and a lot of makeup. Excessive could be a word you could use for it. And she was like, you guys are crazy. You need to go get your own drugs. You're high. You guys are crazy. And I was like, I couldn't be further from it. I was like, what's crazy is dressing up like a clown, sweetheart, and wearing clothes like this when you're clearly like 15 or 16 and living a life. Like, look what's in your basket. Easy cheese is crazy. When something has to say in the packaging that it's made with real food, like, what is that? That's crazy. This is crazy. Just continuing and allowing this to happen day in and day out is crazy. Although I understand her point of view, too. We definitely were screaming and yelling inside of the Walmart. But it's so awesome to look back a year from then and to see the changes, and to see that those flyers hit home to some people. And the cool thing was that with the internet and with what Occupy's been able to do and the voice that they have garnered through their protest and through what we've done, people are at least starting to wake up and recognize some of the things. And I want to say this, you know, I'm, since when Occupy ended back in November?
November 17th, okay, 2011.
Thank you. Dates aren't my strong point, but I stuck around for two more months till I finished up with the VA, and then I went back to Seattle to be with my children. So I've been in Seattle for the last 11 months, but coming back to Texas this fall versus what it was last fall, I would definitely say the average person, not my Occu family, but the other people that I know, have progressed. I mean, this thing has really, it's really changed people's minds. It's really changed the way people see. And so I know I've gone through times and blogged and written about being upset with how Occupy ended or whatever, but we have to look at like the fact that we did awaken a lot of people. We did share that message. We did get our point across. And by what the military industrial complex did, what the Dallas Police Department did, in my opinion, was just prove our point. Thanks for spending $400,000 in one evening to get 19 kids to stop thinking for themselves in a park. I mean, it's completely absurd. So when I think about everything that's happened from it, my heart is to come back here and help continue it and grow it. And we've got this seed and we've got this little seedling. There's still a lot of work to be done. You know, we need this thing to grow and grow and grow. I look forward to a day when there might be an Occupy party in the presidential debates, you know, that we could have our own. And I know these things are lofty goals, and not that we even have to go that route. I think one of the beauties of Occupy, but something that we're going to have to meet out as we go forward, is none of us wanted to be in a hierarchical type of structure. None of us wanted to be in these pyramid schemes that we've been in our whole life, in schools, in families, in churches, in jobs. We didn't want to do that because we know that these pyramid schemes of men are just that. They're schemes and it's a faulty way of doing things. So I think we all wanted a much more egalitarian type of equality across the board. And that was to our benefit, but it was also a weakness. It was a strength for us, but it was also a weakness. And we've got to learn going forward. We've got to work.
Okay, how is it a strength and how is it a weakness?
Sure. I think that it's a strength in that it helps us to identify that when Bucky, when you and I speak and when you and I have conversations, I respect your opinion just as much as my own because I respect you just as much as I respect myself. And it's not like I go, well, you're this position higher than me or you're a manager and I'm an assistant manager or some type of false premises like that. But it can also be, I don't think this is indicative of our group, but I think it can be a problem with not having leadership is that a lot of people will end up being kind of too lazy to blame. Again, I'm not saying that the group is lazy or anything like that, but that somebody needs to lead. I think it's just the nature of, even if it was not governments, but even just in tribal areas, or even just in, with animals even, there are people that have different roles. And it's not that a leader is necessarily above anyone, but maybe has a different role, you know? I can't do certain, like I think of Melina. Melina has a superpower with administration. I can't be a manager. I'm too, you know, scatterbrained to really be like, I don't, but get at that part, by the way, I'm trying to find and figure this out, but, okay, sorry.
Well, for me, it's the idea of being a facilitator and leading by example.
Right. Exactly. Like servant leadership, like, and it's going forward. We just need to make sure that when you look at the civil rights movement, I mean, you had Martin Luther King. You had Malcolm X. You had guys that had either a passion or an ability to speak or an ability to lead, and it's just kind of necessary. And I've been reading a lot of books since Occupy on civil disobedience. And it is a tightrope that we'll have to walk, and we need to make sure that we're always respectful of everyone's opinion, from the smallest, meekest child, you know, to the loud crazies like some of us are, you know, and we got to make sure that we respect everybody.
Everyone has something to contribute.
Exactly. And I think that, so when I say leader, I don't want to use leader in the classic context, but maybe some type of an organizer or facilitator or people that are just able to use their gifts and their abilities to better the group. That's what I mean really by a leader. And I think we tried to do that with committees, but again, that was such, it was just such a busy, you know, it was kind of, it was an interesting time. And I think, you know, I think a lot of us have gone back and played out all the situations in our head and recognized what was successful, and what, man, we got to do this better next time. And not that it's the next time, because I want to reiterate that this is still a continuation. Occupy is not over. It was an idea. It's a group of peoples. We're not over. It's still going. It's still in my heart. It's still in your heart. We're still doing it right now. So it hasn't gone anywhere. It's just that the actual physical encampment is gone. And I think that that has served its purpose. I don't know that we need to go back to what we already did. I think it's time for, but I certainly think that the collective, we need to be together again. We need to get, like what Rich Kaufman's trying to do, like what you're trying to do, like what's on my heart, like what's with a lot of people. We need to rally the troops and continue and say, okay, what is Occupy? You know, and now we've gotten bogged down in who's, are we this group or that group or what have you? I don't think that matters as much as this is an idea that we serve, and it's an idea that men should be, men and women, and all people should be equal and free and be able to live with, you know, a life that they're proud of and free to just choose their own path. And that we shouldn't judge one another, that we should just love everybody, be like, oh, well, that's Hayden, that's what he does. You know, it might not be what's for me, but I know he's a good guy. Or that's Bucky, he does this, and that's a little bit different than what I do, but I know that guy's got a huge heart and it is for the cause. So, you know, and these aren't like...
I would suggest weekly potlucks somewhere.
Exactly, something like that. What I really hope can happen... And obviously, I've taken a back seat on all this stuff because of my logistics and living in Seattle now. But hopefully, you know, me and my kids will be back down here soon. And we can start going to work on some of these ideas, trying to get a space, you know, trying to get a collective or a flex shop, you know, where people can just do what they want to do, where we can have potlucks. We can have speakers come and talk to whoever wants to be there. We can have a coffee shop going. We can have the artists in our community do it, you know, displaying their art. We can have the people... It's just all kinds of things. You know, I'm really big into these sensory deprivation tanks. I think those would be really good to help us. You know, I know that when you can get into these things, you know, and get rid of all of the... It so helps you meditate. For a guy like me, I'm like a dog, man. I'm all over the place.
Squirrel.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. A squirrel. So I get in there and I can just focus, really get into my third eye, really get into my mind and examine things. And sometimes I get a lot of truths about myself that maybe I wouldn't get if I was trying to look at something else. So it's a really, I think things like this would be really good for our group. And I can also tell you this, you know, and you can probably attest to this being further down the road in your journey and path. But for me at 30, I went back up to Seattle, and I've never really had a hard time making friends in my life. But I found myself not wanting to. I found myself going, you know what, I've got the most beautiful groups of friends down there in Dallas. And even though I lost my love for this city a long time ago, the people in this group restored it. The people at Occupy Dallas changed my heart to where I was back to going like, no, that's my home. And if I'm going to make a difference somewhere in the world, I would like to do it there. Because I know now there's people there that are ready to receive that message and ready to stand with me and stand beside me on this path. And that for a soldier who came home so defeated and so saddened by the realities of the depravity of man and what we do to what's done in the name of that flag, like for a guy who came home and really was struggling with that, everyone out there just really restored my faith in humanity.
Wow, Hayden, that's from the heart.
Yeah, that's all I got. I mean, no, you don't have to end it. I'm just saying that's all I got is stuff from my heart, man.
That's all I need.
Yeah.
We got it right there. God damn.